versus concept maps. What are their differences? Are they describing the same thing, the same concept? It's true that the mind map or the concept map in many texts are indifferently being used, one for the other. But even though they have similarities, they are actually rather different. Because the main difference is that mind map or concept maps are not used for the same purpose. Mind maps are mostly used when you want to explore an idea. They are very good support for brainstorming, creative thinking. And the way they are built is usually to connect simple words. Mind maps are tools for exploring ideas or organizing random information. In a mind map, you always begin with a central topic. For instance, the title of a lecture or the name of a project like reducing greenhouse gas emission in transportation, or a question like how could I lose weight? Then, from this central topic, you will associate the first words related with this central item. And you can use, for instance, as a starting point, the Kipling method, which has been presented in another presentation. And from word to word, you will expand this network of words. Unlike mind maps, concept maps are used when you need to analyze a complex problem. They are very good to identify solutions, and they allow you to connect concepts with actions. So the concept maps are mostly tools for organizing knowledge and take action. We can see a concept map as a visual representation of relationships between items or concepts. These concepts usually are displayed with specific shapes, and these shapes are related with the type of concept we describe. And they are joined by lines or arrows that give a direction to the connection between these different concepts. Unlike the mind maps, for the concept maps, usually these lines contain linking action words, verbs, to show how these ideas are connected. For instance, if we connect a person with a task, the linking between this person and the task will contain a verb regarding what action this person should take, like do the task, supervise the task, review the task, organize the task. And when the concept map is done, usually the structure of this concept map will have many similarities with a flow chart. It's much more organized, much more structured than a mind map. And you might have noticed that for the concept map, I didn't say that we have to begin with a central topic. Regarding the differences we observed between concept maps and mind map, be sure that you will choose the right tool. And depending on making a mind map or concept map, you will work differently. Mind maps are mostly used when you need to proceed via creative thinking, and concept maps are mostly used when you are dealing with a problem analysis. Here are the way to build a mind map. First, you must choose a support adapted to your task, if it's an individual task or a group work. This support can be handwriting, can be a whiteboard, can be sticky notes, can be a software. Then you decide which main concept you will put at the center of your map. Then you will start to write the first concept related with the central one. If you use the Kipling method, you will first put the 6 questions of the Kipling method. Then you will start to list all topics and concepts and questions that can be related with each of these 6 questions. You will add subsequent level with additional detail. You create any additional connection between the different concepts. When the mind map begins to become too complex, it's time to reorganize, restructure, move the sticky note. And something very important, especially when you are doing it with a group, at the end, you must ask for feedback and approval about the conclusion drawn from the mind map you built with the team. When you use a mind map, you will memorize it by the visual impact it can have. If you use it, for instance, as a way to summarize a lecture. So use colors, add pictures that will help your brain to remember not only the content, but also the structure of the mind map, and will help you to retrieve more easily the information contained in this mind map. There are different ways to design a mind map. The first one is the radial mind map. It's usually used when you need to develop some creative thinking. This is an example of a radial mind map with the central question. Then, from it, you develop the first ideas or words or concept that come to your mind and go to the next one, more details, other concepts related with the first one. So this type of mind map is excellent for creative thinking, when you want to explore an idea or when you want to take notes during a lecture. The tree-like mind map is used when you need to organize a project. On this figure, you see that unlike the previous one, you have a very obvious structure for this mind map. It's a really good second step when you begin to organize your work or when you start to create a to-do list. Something important is that you will use it once you have a quite clear idea of the different components of your problem or your project. It's too rigid for 100% fruitful creative thinking, but it's very useful when you start to organize your ideas or your task. The concept map is used when you have to analyze a well-identified problem. In the figure, you see that the structure of a concept map, it's much more organized, and you have verb actions between the different items. So you will use it when you must take action, when you must decide who will do what and how things will interact in a project. In a concept map, usually people will use specific shapes to organize and rank the concept between action, data, users, choices. It's actually quite the last step before building a detailed flowchart. Here's an example. You're in charge of creating the textbook with multiple writers. The first step is to decide which topic will be treated. What type of document? Is it a book, ebook, publishing on the web? And which persons you will contact to write the chapters of this book. In this first step, using a radial mind map will allow you to shake the ideas to see what will be the structure of the book and then what should be the best support for it. When you have a clear view of the different concepts, you can move to a step where you will define what will be the book structure, how many chapters, the type of sub-chapters, what type of material, image, videos should be added. And to describe this, the tree mind map will be much more efficient because its structure is higher. Finally, when you have the structure of the book, you will decide who will be doing what, how people will interact, communicate, how you will be able to provide material to writers. It means that you have to link concept with people and take action. This is why the concept map is a better tool to really finalize this work. And when you have a clear view on the structure of the book, the goal of the books, who will be in charge of what, how the material and interaction will be defined, now you can really define what will be the timeline, what will be the deadline, what will be the milestones of your project. And you move to a flowchart, which is more selective, more specific than the concept map. If we plot two axes, one horizontal going from individual to group, one vertical going from creative thinking to be organized. We can choose when we will be using mind maps or concept maps. We can use a mind map when we need to do some individual learning, when we have to set a work plan, we want to identify a document structure, where we want to write a course outline. We can use it also when we need to be prepared. For example, when we take notes, we summarize a text, we have to take a decision and balance all the plus and minus, and when we want to memorize some content. On a more collective way, mind maps are excellent when we must find ideas, do some group brainstorming. Regarding the concept map, we will use concept map when we must define and manage a project. For instance, we have to lead a meeting, we must organize tasks, we must distribute work, we must plan. Also, in a group, we can use the concept map when it's still creative, but really when we must take action. We must solve a problem, but we must decide who will do what. We must link people with objectives via actions verb. And the last topic is to use concept maps or mind maps in communication. For the communication, for instance, if we need to pitch for ideas, if we want to clarify some items, if we have to report on a meeting, we can use both. Let's summarize the differences between concept maps and mind map. For the mind map, we can build a hierarchical structure. We can build a tree-like or radial-like structure. It's very fast. It's something we use when we want to think about a problem, try to see all the sides of the problems, being very creative. It usually reads from the center to periphery. It's a very flexible structure. It has to be a very flexible structure. Its goal is to enhance the visual impact. We create simple links between words, lines, arrows. Words are mostly randomly placed or combined in clouds. So mind maps are very, very specific tools for any type of creative thinking. Regarding the concept map, it's mostly based on a network of concepts. It takes time to build a real concept map. We don't use a radial or tree-like structure with a central topic. A concept map is built for multiple entry reading. We will follow strict rules like colors, shape. The goal here is to highlight the sequence of actions and check that everything will be done on due time. Connections between the nodes contain action verbs. We have a strict hierarchical structure. So, concept maps are usually the perfect tool for rational analysis. To conclude, you can use mind maps or concept maps. Here are some questions that you should ask before selecting one or the other two. Do you want to explore a problem? Or do you want to organize a task or organize a project? Do you want just to take notes from a lecture, from a seminar? Do you want to analyze a complex problem or a complex project? It will be important that you choose the right tool according to the problem you want to solve. But don't forget that, as usual, these methods are a support for your ideas, your project. So use finally whatever will make you the most comfortable when you explore new ideas, when you define the different aspects of a problem, or must organize a project or task. Because what is the most important is to get a clear vision of your project, your problem, how you will solve it, the ideas you might have, and whatever the tool you use, it will be the perfect tool if it allows you to achieve your goal.